Hello, my name is Brendan, and I am delighted to be here with you right now for the director's commentary of my feature-length Lego movie, From the Ashes, a Star Wars story. I don't have a script for this. I've just hit play on the movie, and I'm going to talk about stuff. It is currently 7:39 p.m. Eastern on the 21st of November, 2021, which means that the premiere of the movie just ended a little over an hour ago. And I gotta start by saying thank you. Over 50 people tuned in to watch the premiere, and for a project that was off the radar and appeared to be abandoned for the better part of a decade, I am overwhelmed with gratitude and joy. It was truly a pleasure to share it with you all today, so thank you to those of you who tuned in, and thank you to everyone who has watched it since. I'll touch on this some more a little later, but the support and enthusiasm and encouragement that you all have shown over the last many years is such a big factor in how this movie came to be finished, because it was a very solitary project after the first 6 months. When the voice acting was done, it became just me, baby, and it was hard sometimes, so thank you. You'll have to bear with me as I go on some tangents. I'm looking at the movie playing right now, and I'm going to be thinking of all kinds of things I want to talk about. For example, this epic opening piece of music was arranged by my brother Jared. While I was working on this movie in school, he was up to his own creative endeavors, and that included digital composing for video games. So he offered to do this overture piece that would include musical motifs that recur throughout the movie, and I'm so grateful. I can't imagine a better way to start the movie off. I am on record from an old Q&A video I did in high school of saying I will not ever make a feature-length Lego movie. It would take way too long, and I was just going to continue to make short films. I was right about one of those things. It did take a long time. I've stopped saying too long, even though sometimes I feel that way. You know, sometimes you get an idea, and then you can't unthink of the idea. That's the Cole's notes of how this movie began to be. To summarize, I had just made a collection of clone troopers with some, you know, red markings that I kind of liked. The figures that would go on to be Winters and Sergeant Stokes, and then there were a couple of others. And I thought, these are a kind of a nice looking crew. I should make a Lego video with them. Probably some kind of a mission, a stealth action sequence or something along those lines. Maybe I'd be ambitious and make a 10-minute video, because that would be longer than anything I had done before. And so I started thinking and mulling it over. What kind of a sequence would it be? Where would it take place? And I started getting little flashes of images, little sequences that actually did make it into this movie. I'll point them out when they happen. And then the idea kind of grew. I took off the helmets of the figures and gave them all faces and hair so that they were, you know, people with little identities. And I took photos and printed them on separate pieces of paper, and I carried them around with me at school. At this time, I was in grade 10, 2011. And just throughout the day, I would just jot down little notes as I thought of bits of backstory, a name, a planet they came from, what their family did. Not all of that information made it into the movie. Again, I'll touch on that later. But it helped me get to know who these characters were. And the more I found out about them, I guess, the bigger the story became. And before I knew it, I had an outline for what would become a feature-length movie. I have with me right now a copy of the script. It went through 3 drafts before I printed out 15 copies that I could distribute to the cast.
like that.
But this script is not the same movie as what From the Ashes has become. It truly has transformed on almost all levels, at least to some degree. I have matured, I think. I hope. There's evidence for over the last 10 years. And the script that I wrote in grade 10 is fine in a lot of ways and excusable in others because I was a kid and I was not only learning about how to be a good writer, learning, as in progress, but there were also some pretty important things about storytelling and about life in general that I hadn't figured out yet or hadn't spent the proper time thinking about. You might reasonably say, you were 15, Brendan. Of course you didn't have it all figured out, so I'm not beating myself up over it nightly. However, I'm not 15 anymore. I'm 25, and I've still got lots to learn in life, but I have learned quite a bit, and to put out this piece of story that I had written at 15, to put it out now would not accurately reflect what I believe to be important in our media, in our social lives, and I'll touch on that with some specifics later on. I've got a lot to talk about, and most assuredly I'm not going to fit it all in. I will try to be concise and stick to the interesting stuff, but this is going to be a big stream of consciousness. So buckle in. I am enjoying a glass of Chardonnay gifted to me by my grandmother. A lovely, thoughtful gift from a wonderful, lovely person who does not drink, nor does she typically give alcohol to others, but she came to watch the movie for the first time with me just a week before its release. And she gifted me this bottle of white wine and said, "This has been on my shelf for 8 years. I was waiting for an occasion, and here's the occasion." And I said, "Thank you, Grandma. You have been holding on to this bottle of wine for almost as long as I've been working on the movie." Somehow it felt symbolic or appropriate.
What does this have to do with the Jedi?
So catching up on the film, at this point we are past the laboratory scene where they're discussing the nanomites containing the poison that targets clone troopers, the DNA of Jango Fett, meaning that you can release it into crowds of people and it won't affect them whatsoever, but it can take out, you know, scores of Republic soldiers with no other casualties. This plot line was something I cooked up out of the need to introduce characters that weren't clones. You know, I love clones. I love the Clone Wars, but that wasn't the story I wanted to tell. They weren't the characters I wanted to share. My voice actors were all friends or bandmates or colleagues or teachers of mine, and I didn't want to have them impersonating troopers. I wanted them to be largely themselves. There's a lot of their own personalities that shine through in these characters, which is what I think makes them work so well. So, with the need to introduce non-clone soldiers, came a plot that disqualified clones from being able to complete it. When I started working on this movie, the Clone Wars TV show was, you know, a few years into its running, but it had many left to go, and I was an avid viewer, big fan, and I was always just kind of crossing my fingers behind my back, going, "I hope they don't do a clone poison before I finish From the Ashes, because then it would look like I copied it." And thankfully, they never did. The DNA targeting poison remains an original idea to fit the need of introducing this cast of characters. The two characters who are speaking now, that's Captain Winters and Master Maginus Kayes, are voiced by two of my high school teachers, that's Mr. Hikala and Mr. Deloey. When I was in school, I got along with lots of people and I enjoyed the company of many of my peers, but I spent most of my time with faculty. For extracurricular reasons, but also just because they were really cool. I had a lot of cool teachers during my time in school, as evidenced by their participation in my Lego Star Wars stop-motion movie. Also here in the roster of the cast are my mom and my dad, who play Sev and Stokes, and they would prove instrumental in allowing From the Ashes to transform into what it is now, a piece of media and a story that I'm really proud of. The reason why that's the case is that all of the voice acting was done right at the beginning. When I finished the script, then I brought in the actors, and we did everything. So I have tons and tons of voice lines sorted into folders for every character and every scene, and then I started filming.
And because the filming took a decade,
all of those wonderful people who provided voices moved on with their lives, sometimes to a great distance. And I no longer had access to them in the same way, to have them come and do new voice lines if I wanted to change something. That's not to say that some of them wouldn't have done it if I had asked, because largely I didn't ask. I kept working with what I had. But it wasn't as easy as it would have been back when we were, you know, all in school together, to just come on over to Brendan's house and speak into a microphone for a bit. That limitation actually ended up becoming something of a positive in my production experience, because I think as I grew and matured and became dissatisfied with what I had written, I think I would have continually rewritten and scrapped and started again to no end if I had been allowed to. But because I didn't want to recast these characters, I loved the performances that everybody did. I made the commitment to myself that I was going to work with the material that I had. I had tons of sound bites. And just allow myself to rewrite the three actors I still had access to. That would be my mom, Anita, who played Sev, my dad, Brian, who played Stokes, and me, who played Riley, which, by the way, was never actually my intention. When I was in school looking for people to play certain characters, I just never found somebody who connected with Riley or felt like the right fit for Riley, so my stand-in lines ended up sticking. This scene we're looking at right now with Andy and Riley at the table together is a great example of this. In the script, oh, it is a cringy conversation of my grade 10-year-old self trying to ice break between two new people who are going to have to get along in this movie. And I just did not know how to write it properly. There was a lot of, you know, you're very easy to talk to. Something about you is very trustworthy. And so here's my life story kind of vibes. Just not natural, not interesting. It just took you right out of it. It also made it very long. This scene was like 13 or 14 minutes in its original iteration. And unfortunately, I filmed the whole 14 minutes. It has been cut back a couple of times. I don't have it in front of me, but I think now it might be 6 minutes. There's a lot of content where Andy explains who the team members are, and they talk about Sev, the mysterious sniper, and what Sev's background might be, and how he joined the team, because at the time, Sev was a male character. We'll touch back on that later. It was clunky, it was full of exposition, I didn't like it, and I wanted to change it. But I didn't really have access to Helen's talent anymore. She was off living her life, Alan being the voice actor who played Andy. So instead, I just rewrote Riley's lines. And it is incredible how much you can change a conversation when you rework just even half of it. Because suddenly Andy's responses took on entirely new meaning, depending on what Riley had said to her. That, combined with cutting out a lot of that unnecessary stuff, made this scene much more bearable. the third thing that helped was music. There was a long way into this production process where these scenes did not have music. And it dragged. It really did. I was relieved when I finally got to the music stage and found, wow, an instrumental score behind this actually helps keep it feeling like a narrative moving forward and not just two people talking at a table. Because even though I love the prequels and I loved trying to take inspiration from the Star Wars movies where I could, I did not really want to emulate the two people talking at a trait of the prequels, you know? Two people on a couch, two people in a hallway, two people in a field of flowers. And here I was with this huge, long, bloated scene full of exposition as Riley and Andy are talking at this table. And it really felt better afterwards to cut away, like chiseling, you know, rock off of a sculpture down to just the necessities and keeping it on topic with the plot of the movie. I mentioned earlier that every character had a backstory, and I was incorrectly convinced that I had to kind of shoehorn them all in because, well, if I didn't put them in the movie, no one would ever know them. And in high school, I thought everyone had to know everything about these characters. So there were just, you know, huge amounts of dialogue shoved in to tell you about, you know, how Sev used to be a criminal, like an assassin, a wanted sniper, and is now, you know, serving time with the Grand Army of the Republic. And in fact, Sev had been the one to assassinate the parents of Riley, and that was revealed after the shooting competition that is still in the movie between Sev and Riley. It's just taken on a new tone. So all of that extra stuff being gone really benefited the film. It hurt my soul a little bit to cut out content that I had already filmed. Lots of you who watched the movie and stuck around all this time are brick filmers yourselves, so I'm preaching to the choir here. It takes a long time, and making something that took you hours, days, weeks, and then erasing it from the movie, ooh, that did not feel good in the moment. But in the big picture, the movie became better for it. I think a lot of this commentary is going to be me telling you how bad From the Ashes used to be over the course of the production. And I can chuckle about it now because I'm proud of what I put out. I'm happy with how it is. But there are some things that I wrote before that I wouldn't feel good putting out with my name on it now. One of them is coming up on screen. I don't think I would have included this little gag about, you know, Marty hitting on Riley's deceased sister. In hindsight, it's a little uncomfy. I don't know. It's awkward and yeah. But it was too tangled to take out. I didn't have another way to finish the scene. The next scene where Marty and Riley speak kicks off with an apology that wouldn't make sense. So it had to stay. Thankfully, nobody in my test screenings expressed any, you know, discomfort about it, and it did get some chuckles. Somebody went even so far as to say that the awkwardness made them feel more human because, you know, something like that could happen in real life. You absolutely might just step on a rake and then not know what to say next, like Marty did. It isn't quite as problematic as some of the other elements that used to be in the script and were removed, and I will touch on those later. On a more technical note of improvement, I don't know what was going on with my camera and lighting setup in high school, but all of these early scenes on the ship, this one being the worst offender, were just yellow. If I had never set a deadline to release From the Ashes, I'm sure the task I would still be working on forever would be color correction. It was a constant ongoing battle to try to un-yellowify my earlier footage to bring it more in line with what I filmed in the more recent years. I actually briefly looked into what it would cost to outsource the color correction process to a professional company because I was just I was struggling. I didn't feel like I was attaining the look that I wanted, and I didn't know how to fix it, no matter how many YouTube tutorials I watched. It ended up being out of the price range to do that. And I also didn't want to put an asterisk next to my name on this movie. Because as it stands, I did the whole thing. Aside from the cast and some of the music, this was all me. And I'm very proud of that. So, for better or worse, no matter how the colors turned out, I'm still glad I can stand by it as my own work. If you look in the background of this scene, you can see the helmets of Stokes and Winters. And in the next scene coming up, you can see all the helmets of Dale, Riley, Marty, and Lee. These helmets, they change partway through the movie. When I started making this film, I knew I wanted to use Phase 2 helmets. There's something about that Revenge of the Sith look, especially in Lego, that is very nostalgic for me. And I knew that was the look I wanted, as opposed to the Phase 1 clones. At the time, the only Phase 2 helmets that existed were the original, 2005 clone helmets with the cutaway visor that you see through to like a pitch black head inside. Here is Riley walking on screen with one right now. And there's that big like chin piece hanging down over the torso. It meant when you turned the head, the whole helmet would like raise up as the chin tried to get over the shoulder. It was just very strange and weird to animate. Then, because the movie took 10 years, Lego released new models. Better models. They look better. They turn on the shoulders better. And I wanted to use them. I was going through this moment of, I would have to reshoot several scenes because they're wearing the 2005 helmets. But I finally decided, no, I'm not going to reshoot the scenes. I'm going to just switch to the new helmets and see who notices. I thought everyone was going to notice. But in fact, nobody did in my real-life viewings of the movie. Granted, they're not, Lego Star Wars aficionados like I and many of you on YouTube are, but until I pointed it out, virtually nobody saw the difference. And then they were like, no, go back, show me the earlier scenes to prove they're different because, when you're not paying attention to them and you're not as familiar with every minifigure and Lego set from the last 20 years, I guess it doesn't stand out as much as I thought it was going to. But even for the people that do notice the difference, I'm trusting that the consensus will be, yes, the new helmets are superior and switching was a good choice. This scene is one of my favorites. I just like how the dynamic worked out between these four, Marty, Lee, Dale, and Riley, in this kind of, summer camp cabin kind of vibe, not quite locker room, but it's more like going to bed at camp. I don't know. And it's a relief because none of the actors at any time were in the same room as one another while they were recording their lines. All the voice acting was done while I was still living at home with my parents in my, basement bedroom studio space. And so just one at a time was the only way to do it. So even though the actors for example, Lee and Marty, Ben and Martin are their names, were really close at the time. They didn't have each other to bounce off of in person. So, no, everyone did a spectacular job. And in comes Sergeant Bruce Stokes, the squad father figure, who I did not intend to write out that way at the beginning. But as soon as I landed on the fact that it was going to be my dad, Brian, providing his voice, it just all of his lines ended up coming out like how my dad talks. And that was one piece of feedback from the premiere was, for a military unit, this group has a very chill vibe. And Sergeant Stokes in particular, much more fatherly and caring than, the one would imagine the typical drill sergeant to be. You better get to sleep. I do not have any experience with the military personally to draw from, so there's that. But also, I wanted these characters to be likable. I wanted you to care about them, because I care about them. And where Winters, as the captain, had this kind of grizzled wisdom about him, I needed someone with a little more heart and care, like a dad. And, surprise, surprise, it ended up being my dad.
Good morning.
So this scene right here not only features the cameo of the most important actor in any stop-motion film, Sticky Tack. This scene is what's left over of one of only two deleted scenes from the movie entirely. I mentioned I cut a lot of content, but mostly it was portions of scenes, cutting out tangents and dialogue. But two scenes altogether were filmed and then erased. The reason for the one in the cafeteria there was just because it was redundant. The dialogue just rehashed exactly what the sergeant and the four of them talked about in the room the night before, which on screen was just mere seconds earlier. It was just, I don't know. It was redundant, it was repetitive, and it was cleaner to take it out. Now that scene gets to serve as a segue into the Force chat. I knew there were going to be many people watching this in my personal life that were not familiar with Star Wars, or at least not as familiar with Star Wars.
No, I don't think so.
I wanted to find a way to inform people. Like, in my mind, it was my grandma, the same one who gave me the Chardonnay for the premiere. She's never seen Star Wars, but she knows how much I love it, and so she was here to watch the movie. But she doesn't have any context to pull from the main Star Wars saga or anything. So I wanted to include an opportunity to explain the Force and the Jedi in a way that was going to be helpful for people who didn't know, but also not, you know, boring for people who do know already. Because, of course, on the internet, most people who click their way onto this movie are going to be Star Wars fans already. The tried and true way to handle that is for your protagonist to have no idea what's going on, or a very basic or limited understanding of what's happening, so that it needs to be explained to them. And then at the same time, your audience members get that explanation also. That's been around for ages. It's just very helpful and applicable here, as Riley gets an introduction to the Force. This feels like as good a time as any to mention Rod Hicola, who did the voice for Captain Winters. He had a lot of material to go through. Winters had more lines of dialogue than anyone else in the film, especially before I started trimming things back. And he did it all in a day. One take, most of the time. Exceptionally talented individual. He also happens to be the father of Helen Hicola, who played Andy, so very talented family. The force is strong in that family. The music that's playing right now is arranged by me. I hesitate to say that I wrote it, because obviously it is deeply reminiscent of one of the themes from Star Wars. But it's not quite the same for copyright reasons. None of the music is lifted from Star Wars, but it's meant to evoke the same feeling and call back to those, you know, original trilogy, binary sunset kind of scenes when the Force was explained the first time around. Like most of the music tracks that are original in this movie, it is interwoven in and out with what I'd call the theme, the main theme of From the Ashes. You'll hear that a few times. There are two of them. One of them I view as the squad theme, and the other one kind of comes off as Riley's theme specifically. In this particular scene, there are also little notes reminiscent of Bastila's theme from the Knights of the Old Republic video game, because I love that video game. We're not going to get onto a KOTOR tangent, but just so it's on record, far and away my favorite video game experience was playing KOTOR blind. It's a 20-year-old game. There's a remake around the corner. If you've never tried it before, it is definitely worth checking out. Some of the best Star Wars content that's available. So here we're coming up on the scene that introduces Sev. Sev, the sniper of the squad. There's a lot to talk about with Sev. Starting with, I love the character that Sev has become. As if anyone were to get a most improved medal, I think, from the initial conception of the character to the final execution, I feel it goes to Sev. So let's talk about that while Sev and Riley have their contest. Sev began as an edgy, brooding kind of a character. You know, at the age that I was, that was kind of the vibe that snipers gave off. You know, there's that, Bad Batch is out, and Crosshair is an exact example of what I'm talking about, right? Even Sev's namesake, which is Sev the Sniper from Republic Commando, fits this trope as well. The sniper is always the rogue, the shady character in the corner with the hat tipped down and the collar pulled high, you know? That was Sev. Sev was a Mandalorian bounty hunter, assassin, wanted criminal who was so good with a sniper rifle. The Republic put him, because at the time Sev was male, put him to work in Winters' unit. There was also a backstory that involved the loss of Riley's parents was a more prominent thing in this one. It wasn't just that they died, it was that they were killed by an unknown assailant for political reasons. His parents were, you know, senators. And it turned out that it was Sev who did that, who took that job and assassinated the parents of Riley. It was just too much. There was too much going on in the movie, and it never went anywhere because Sev's character still... spoiler warning. You shouldn't be watching this commentary before you've seen the movie on its own, but consider this the spoiler warning from here on out for plot details. Okay. Sev still dies at the hands of Dooku, even in the original script, so the plot never went anywhere. It had no purpose in the movie. So it was cut. It was also important that I dial back the significance of the deaths of Riley's parents, because Riley's main motivator is getting over the grief of the loss of his sister, avenging her, but also finding a purpose without her. And throwing in grief over his parents too, it was distracting from the main through line of Riley's character. So instead, the parents have been dead since he was a tiny baby. He didn't lose a personal relationship with them. And Sev no longer needed to be the assassin responsible. But originally, I needed a way to tell the audience about this assassination thing. And Sev, the broody, edgy sniper, is not going to just open up and talk to Riley about that. We needed to impress Sev. So that's where this scene originally came. Sev was doing, you know, a shooting practice, and in walks Riley, and Sev won't talk to him, and Riley grabs a rifle and starts shooting, and Sev goes, "Wow, this kid can shoot. I guess you're all right. Let's talk." It was just not good. It was not good. So all of that was scrapped. She's still not approachable by any means. She's got that kind of hard edginess to her still, but it's toned back a lot. I'm going to talk more about Sev shortly, but first I want to talk about this scene a little bit because it's one of my favorites. And it wasn't in the original script at all. So as I was doing rewrites for Sev, I was talking with my mom, who is the voice for Sev, and the assassination thing was still in place. And I was like, well, how do we get her to open up and talk about this? And she says, drinking. I was like, that's perfect. Absolutely. So Sev and Riley go for drinks, and then it's going to come out how Sev assassinated Riley's parents. Then I scratched the assassination. Well, they're still at the bar. Okay. Instead, the scene is going to be like a foreboding, doom and gloom kind of, we're about to die, so cheers kind of vibe, right? And the scene was going to cut and then go to the hyperspace scene that comes up in a minute, and we're just supposed to be left with this feeling of, oh boy, hope the mission goes okay. And then I did another pass. And what I realized was that more important to me than the mission itself was the theme of the movie. Before they leave the screen, I want to share that Sev's black ale is soy sauce, and Riley's Bespin Sparkle is strawberry jam. Nothing else would hold their color, the dark brown color and the red color, at such a small volume. I had a small little syringe that I could use to suck out the soy sauce as Sev drank it. There are also many cameos in the background from my earlier Lego films. Of note, just behind Sev sitting with a golden cup is the first minifigure I ever put on screen. The video was called The Ultimate Clone Trooper Dance Down, and it's still on YouTube if you know where to find it. Let me know in the comments if you recognize any of the other cameos. So, back to the theme of From the Ashes. When I was first putting the idea together, there wasn't really a theme. It was just an action 10-minute idea. But most of the characters died. I have spent some time trying to figure out why 15-year-old me wanted to kill all these characters so badly. Rogue One had not yet come out, so it can't have been that, but I think it must have been The Walking Dead. In fact, I'm pretty sure that's why Dale is named Dale, because, well, you know. But as it became more of a movie, I decided I wanted to have a theme. So I thought, all right, I've got this story where most of the characters die at the end. Maybe the theme is about loss and dealing with grief. And so the line I was pulling from was Yoda's from Revenge of the Sith, when he says, "Train yourself to let go of everything you fear to lose." From the Ashes was going to be something of an echoing of that sentiment. And then as I grew, I realized I actually don't really agree with Yoda's line. I feel differently. I think it's okay to get attached, and it's okay to mourn the loss of someone or something that you loved. My movie became a response to Yoda, a counterpoint. Loss is inevitable. You don't need to shove it down, and you can overcome it. This is the part where I disclose that I, as a 25-year-old, have not yet had to deal with any deep loss of human family members from my immediate circle. The grandparents that I've known for my life are all still here. My parents, my brother, my extended family, I have not yet really dealt with death. And on one hand, that gives anyone grounds to say, well, what business do you have making a movie about dealing with loss? What do you know about it? And the answer is, well, from personal experience, not much. But I really do have excellent role models for this. Both of my parents suffered extreme loss in their lives, people very close to them. And they passed on these wisdoms to me, I guess, about how to deal with loss in an effort to prepare me for when I inevitably will. In a way, that's what this movie has become. It's a message for other people, sure, but it's also something of a self-help tool for me down the road. Whenever I need it, for whatever I need it for. I didn't quite do this on purpose, but the reality is I have audio clips of my mom playing Sev, and at the end of the movie, my dad playing Stokes, each consoling and encouraging Riley, played by me, about how to deal or get past intense loss. And I'm grateful that exists now. I'm grateful that no matter what happens, I can listen to this and hear my folks tell me it's going to be okay.
I hate sand. Why is that? It's coarse, rough, and irritating, and it gets everywhere.
Speaking of sand, the sand used in this film is cat litter. So, thank you, Raz, for your second contribution after the cat hair. It is clean litter. So, let's talk about why Sev went from being a male character to a female character. I was really lucky growing up with the parents that I had, the family that I had. I had really good role models and examples to love everybody, no matter who they are, and to not hate anybody for who they are or where they come from. So growing up, it was just this default stance. I don't have any problem with women in media or in positions of power. Just like I don't have any problem with gay people or their right to be married, or trans people and their right to exist. Or I would think, why on earth would the color of somebody's skin have any impact on how I should feel about them? A person's a person. And then, at some point during the production of the film, I had this eye-opening moment of self-reflection where even though I did not think I was bigoted, and I tried very hard to not be a bigot, I had assembled a cast for this movie that was all white, mostly men, and the only female character with a name was like the most cringy, I'm not a damsel kind of overcompensation that it loops back around to being sexist. I said in some of the behind the scenes footage, I said she's not. She can keep up with the boys just fine. But like, that's still a problem. The fact that you have to define her by her ability to be masculine, that's not okay. These were some of the problems I was alluding to earlier. My original script that I'm holding in my hand right here, the dialogue that comes from Andy is something I'm ashamed of. Or I would be ashamed of it if I were to put it out now. I'm grateful that I matured enough to change it before I released it. And it has nothing to do with the performance delivered by Helen. She was incredible. It is just what I wrote. I thought I was writing this strong soldier woman, and she opened up to Riley immediately and needed Riley to help talk her through her feelings about her abusive father. And it was cringy, but all of the voice acting was already done. So instead of rewriting Andy, I streamlined Andy along with the rest of the movie, but Andy in particular. There is a lot of material that was recorded for Andy that is not used, and the movie is better because of it. It's just a shame because if I could do the whole thing again, I would love to have done a better job with Andy. So around the time that I had this realization, I looked at the movie that was done to that point and said, I want to fix this. I want my movie to be more representative than it is, and I want it to be less misogynistic than it currently is, accidentally, but still was. And at that point, I had not filmed any scenes with Sev up close. There was a scene with Sev in the mission briefing room in Act 1 where Sev was wearing a helmet, and Sev was in the cafeteria for the scene where Riley and Andy are talking to one another for the first time. But Sev was in the background, out of focus. So my point was, there was no scene yet with Sev's face clearly visible, and that allowed me to switch it and put on what appears to be a female face on the character of Sev, and allowed me to transform her from a man into a woman. There was a window while I was, you know, figuring out my way as a filmmaker and a consumer of media where I used to think, and I'm not super proud of this. I debated whether or not to include this little tangent at all, but I think it's important in the development of the movie and the development of me as a storyteller and as a person. So here we go. There was a time when I equated forced diversity in media to tokenism, because it felt like reducing a person, an actor or a musician or what have you, down to one trait about themselves and only including them in whatever the piece of media was for the sake of checking a box on a list. I thought that was almost as bad as excluding them in the first place. Something about the concept felt demeaning to me. And then I realized a few things. Firstly, I realized that as a straight, white, cis male living in a first world country, I really don't get to decide what is demeaning to other people. I need to listen to other people when they share what is or isn't demeaning to them and what's important to them. And I also realized that when I watch movies, TV shows, I, as a white guy, am always represented. There are characters that I can identify with in everything. That's not true for members of the LGBT community. That's not true for people of color. That's not true for people who aren't me. And it is more important that a young person of any nationality or orientation or identity can go to the movies or turn on a streaming service or read a book and be able to identify with a character not feel excluded by a cast of all white people, for instance. So that is how I feel now. And I had this movie that was half done that I dearly did not want to restart, but I would feel badly releasing it into the world when it no longer held up to the standards that I view as important now. I am not going to pretend that changing Sev from a man to a woman and dropping a line to allude to the fact that she's gay. She mentions her wife. She had a wife, and her wife died with her clan. That doesn't fix everything. I'm not going to go, oh, I did it. I've got an LGBT member on the team. And no. If I were doing it again, diversifying the cast is the first thing on my to change list. And that being said, I was not going to be able to start the movie over. If I did, I never would have finished it. So I hope viewers are okay with this, but I made the choice to change what I could without starting over and release the film anyway. And even though I don't think it was enough by my current standards, it's better than it was, but it's still on my mind, I guess. It's the project's code name. And I think there was a factor too in self-reflection of surprise and distress that, how was I that thoughtless? You know, and the answer is, well, you were 15, Brennan. But still, you know, there are so many small but impactful things that I just never used to pay attention to. Like language, for instance, exclusivity in language. There are some lines in this movie that I was thankfully able to edit through splicing to change the words that are spoken. For example, when Winters is speaking with Riley about the Force and he's explaining the midichlorians, the original line was, a person's midichlorian count determines his or her sensitivity to it. And that covers men and women, or those who identify as men and women, but it excludes anybody who is non-binary or gender fluid. And it was a small amount of effort for me to find some other moment in the film when Winters says the word there and crop out that word and replace his or her with there. So the new sentence is, a person's midichlorian count determines their sensitivity to it. And now it's inclusive. So some changes are easier than others, but the effort is important. I think that's what I'm getting down to here is, as creators of media, films, books, illustrations, it doesn't matter where you are, that nobody's perfect. I'm not perfect. I wasn't. I'm still not. But the effort matters. And we can always do better.
Looks like we've got some work to do. Move out.
Rock, paper, scissors. So let's talk about the plot a little bit. Because the team has landed on Eridus. They have made their way down to the bottom of the mountain base where the poison gas laboratory is located. In the original script, The droid starfighters, which, by the way, I only had one of those droid starfighter models. So when they're down there placing all the grenades and such, or when they look at it from over the balcony, there was a lot of green screening and compositing involved in taking my one model and multiplying it into a fleet. But Andy accesses the computer, and it says the ships are programmed to fly to Kamino, which, of course, would be a disaster because it would wipe out the cloning facilities. Instead now, the project is called Backup Plan, and I like to think it fits into the Star Wars canon narrative kind of okay. There's two ways you can interpret it. For one, Palpatine and Dooku could together have come up with this plan as a backup in case the inhibitor chip Order 66 plan did not work, and in fact the clones were not obedient and stayed loyal to the Jedi, this would be a backup way to take care of them. The second way to interpret it, and my personal favorite, is that Palpatine was not involved in this at all. This was just Dooku. And this whole poison gas thing is a backup plan for him in case Sidious betrays him, as the Sith are known to do. I also think that Dooku, as an intellectual person, would get an ironic chuckle out of naming the project something Mandalorian, since it's Jango Fett's DNA. So at this time, I need to issue an apology to someone who was watching the premiere live. And that person's name was Ryan Hensley. right at about this moment, Ryan said in the chat, quote, I'm loving these characters, especially Jarvis, end quote. Jarvis, of course, being Dale Jarvis, the radio tech. And, well.
I'm sure they're right on schedule.
What schedule? I don't remember getting a...
I'm so sorry, Ryan. I did not do that on purpose to you. Way back near the beginning of the movie, in the scene where the four of them, Riley, Dale, Marty, and Lee, are in their bunk room together, that scene used to have some more significance to the theme. Dale, from up on the top bunk, was talking with Riley, and Riley made a comment about how he was struggling and to find purpose. It was very awkwardly written and kind of shoehorned in. That's why I changed it. But Dale had a response of, well, there's always a reason to keep going. Remember that, new guy. And that's when he had kind of jumped down off the bunk and gave Riley the little punch on the leg or whatever. So the job of delivering the theme of the movie, at least the first time around, moved to Sev in the bar scene. And it was redundant for Dale to do it also, especially in a way that was not written very well. So I trimmed that down, and it instead becomes just a short interaction that ends with Dale saying to Riley, you know, make sure that you appreciate these days where you don't have to worry about being shot at any moment. Sorry, Dale. And now we come to the moment that gave Lee Jenkins his namesake. In the original draft, his name was actually Lloyd Jenkins. And I got to this part of the script, and I thought, wouldn't it be funny? Oh, wouldn't everyone get a chuckle if I made a Leroy Jenkins reference? In fact, in the original script, Lee says, all right, chum, let's do this, and starts walking. And Marty says, oh my God, he just ran in. It was not tone appropriate, and it was cut. For context, Leroy Jenkins is an inside joke to the players of World of Warcraft. One player in particular who charged ahead of his comrades shouting, Leroy Jenkins! It's an internet thing. As I was putting this movie together, there were certain scenes that were in my head from very early on, and I could visualize them so clearly. And this was one of them. Was Dooku walking down the ramp, hoisting Lee into the air, and Marty drawing his gun, and then Dooku grinning as he lowers Lee down into the path of the blaster bolt. It really does make you sad as a creator to put the death of a character on paper or on screen. They feel real to you in some way. And killing them is kind of hard. But if you can make the audience feel something, you've done something right. And there's probably no better way to introduce a villain and raise the stakes than for them to off someone the moment they walk on screen, especially if it's someone you care about. This lightsaber sequence was in the script from the very beginning, and I wanted to exemplify the hopelessness of Marty's situation. When I first watched the movie with my partner, Carissa, and Marty took out his lightsaber, she said, oh, buddy. That was exactly the emotion I was hoping to convey. In contrast to the fight at the end of this movie, this saber duel is slow-paced because Marty doesn't know what he's doing, and Dooku is toying with him and enjoying it. I love Count Dooku as a villain. He's got poise and dignity, but he's still evil. There's still a delight in the suffering of others that comes from someone who's given themselves over to the dark side. That can make some of the most compelling villains. It's the Thanos effect, right? It's the people going, well, technically Thanos is kind of right, but, you know, don't be confused. Thanos is still a villain. And Dooku is kind of right about the Jedi. If you read the books and such, he becomes discontented and he leaves the Jedi because of their complacency and their tying up in politics. It's like Revan left for the same reasons, if you're an expanded universe kind of buff, right? But that doesn't make Dooku right, because you've crossed the line into villainy. This battle scene is probably, definitely, the scene that took the longest to put together. And in fact, it consolidates a lot of plot or narrative points that used to be split apart into separate scenes. After this scene, characters are moved into different places they need to be for the story to continue. Andy and Riley are separated from the others. Sev is killed, and Stokes and Winters are taken into captivity. In the original scene, it was Droidicas that came into this room, and the team used a grenade, which caused a rock slide, and the room caved in because it's a mountain, and Riley and Andy were trapped under the rocks. Switching to super battle droids and allowing them to use wrist rockets to damage the elevator and send them plummeting to the bottom of the elevator shaft not only looked much cooler, but it made way more sense because in the first script, the other characters had to leave and deal with Dooku and just leave Riley and Andy underneath the rocks without even checking to see if they're okay. It worked in the abstractness of my head, but once I actually tried to plan out the sequence of events, this doesn't make any sense. Furthermore, the duel with Dooku was in a separate room. They set up an ambush for him. And then I realized, why does it have to be in a different room? Just have him walk in right here. Again, streamlining. This fight was fun to choreograph because in almost any circumstance, a Force user versus a trooper would be no contest. But we rid Dooku of his lightsaber, and then we have some fun with, you know, flying droid parts and acrobatics. Also of note is the fact that Winters is a Force user, and he's holding back in this fight for the sake of a reveal, or, as the Disney sequels so helpfully provided, apparently if you step away from the Force, you somewhat lose your ability to conjure it, as did Luke Skywalker in Last Jedi. So, thanks Disney for validating my plotline just a little bit in that way. The shot of Dooku being pushed down the elevator shaft in a second here provided an unexpectedly unique little challenge of verticality. He has to fall down, and I wanted to show the edge of the shaft and the fact that there was a down to go, so to speak. But this whole movie was filmed on a table on a flat surface, so that shot, as well as when Andy and Riley climb up, involved pulling the whole set right to the edge and then building down the side of the table a little bit. That's going to segue pretty well into the first question I have from the live premiere. When the movie was airing on YouTube, I let everybody know that I was going to be doing a commentary, and if they had any questions, I would be thrilled to answer them here. So the first question goes right along with the subject of set building. It's from user Eric Levine. Hi, Eric. He asks, how was the shooting broken down? Did you go by the script? Was it broken down by set piece, etc.? I started filming the movie in chronological order. So I began at the beginning of the script and just went through, you know, act one, scene one, Riley, and onwards. Riley. But then when I got far enough Riley. Into the film that Wait certain back. Set pieces were going to be used again later on, I would do those scenes while the set was still built. So when the team landed on Eridus, for example, and we were outside in the desert, after shooting those arrival scenes, I went ahead right to the finale when Winters, Stokes, and Riley burst back out the doors outside, and it's at, you know, sundown. I've mentioned a couple of scenes in particular that I would call favorites of mine. We're about to come up on another one. This conversation scene between Dooku and Winters just puts a big old smile on my face because it's the same actor playing both characters.
I'm afraid I can't quite make out what you're saying.
This is a good opportunity for another question from the premiere. This is from user William Marceau. He asks, how do you do that with a flashlight? And what he's referring to is somebody else had said that they liked the lighting, and I said, thank you, there's a lot of flashlights at work. And then came William's question, how do you do that with a flashlight? So in my typical lighting setup, I had a couple of desk lamps that were above the set, and they had the very handy feature of being able to change the hue of the light from warm to neutral to cold white light. Just helped give a little bit of a difference between the different areas of the movie. You know, that way the separatist base can come off a little colder, a little greener than the Republic ship was, which had a more of a warm kind of red tone to it.
He was killed by one of
In addition to those lights, I had several handheld flashlights, and I would make color lenses for them using like sheet protectors, you know, the clear sleeves you put paper into, cut them out, use a Sharpie to color onto it, and then I would tape these colored pieces of thin plastic to the flashlights to give them a beam of color. And those flashlights are what I used for lightsaber glow and blaster bolts, Dooku's lightning, and then certain set elements like the interrogation room here has a blue light coming down, and transitioning on screen right now, the green light of Andy's glow lamp. If you're looking to pull off this effect yourself, you're going to need something to hold up the flashlights with. Obviously, your hands are going to be busy moving the figures of your set. My suggestion is to get microphone boom stands. Being a musician, a singer, and a performer, I have a few of those kicking around. And I would set up these boom arm stands with the flashlights above the set. That even allowed me to animate them, you know, so I would change the location of the light to emulate the trajectory of a blaster bolt between every frame that was shot, and then I would put in the actual bolts with computer effects afterwards. Having that practical light on set, though, they really sold the special effects for me. I used them when the explosions were happening from the super battle droid wrist rockets. Basically, anytime anything lit up, I would try to use a flashlight to amplify the effect, because it sells it when the light hits everything else on set and it's not just computer effects. This scene right here was another one that had a lot of cut dialogue from it. And again, the movie is stronger for it, but it really does strip down the material that I had written for Andy and Riley together. This scene ended with a kiss. So the time that they were trapped underneath what was originally a rock slide led them to bond and talk. Andy opened up some disturbing details about her past, and that connection led them to a kiss. And it was during the kiss that the rock started to move. So, you know, as Riley was feeling this love and emotion, his connection to the Force strengthened. The problem is that I just really didn't like how I wrote the romance. It was rushed. I mean, they've only known each other a couple of days. It was awkward. It ended up being stronger just to remove it entirely. Obviously, we're getting little notes here that Riley does care for Andy in that way. I made the choice to remove from the movie any direct indication that Andy reciprocates those feelings, just because, again, I don't want to reduce her to a love interest for Riley. Maybe she does, maybe she doesn't. But either way, the relationship element between Riley and Andy is that of comrades with the potential, the possibility of romance that, as we're about to watch, tragically never gets to play out. This sequence originally just took place in a hallway. They escaped out of the rock slide elevator and were on their way to meet up, and they ran into a squad of battle droids, and in the same sequence of events kind of happened. I decided a hallway was kind of boring and didn't give you a lot of room for choreography, so I decided, what else can I do with this instead? And I thought, well, some time has passed, right? They were unconscious at the bottom of the elevator shaft, and Stokes and Winters are in custody. What else would be happening? And the answer is, well, of course, the droids are going to be cleaning up the battle site. So when they get to the top of the elevator, there's cleanup droids in here. It allows the exact same narrative beats to hit, but gives a sense of continuity, I guess, immersion in the fact that this is a real base with droids that have jobs to do, you know? Thanks again to Disney for this cool new Force power, you know, borrowing a little bit from Kylo Ren here. The Force stopping of the laser was not in the original script, but this was. Andy always saved Riley at the expense of her own life. I wasn't trying to be mean to the audience, I promise, but there was some intention behind the scene at the bottom of the elevator coming off as the rallying from the low point. You know, when they're at the bottom of the elevator and Stokes and Winters are in captivity, it feels like the low point of the movie. And then Riley overcoming his self-doubt and successfully using the Force, it feels like the good guys are about to be on the up again. But one of the themes of this movie, to borrow Sev's words from earlier, are that life changes, often suddenly, in ways you don't like and can't control. Things don't always go according to plan. And I wanted to sort of tease the triumphant Act 3 a little bit early so that we could be reminded things don't always go how we think they will. Even movies.
What have we here?
So we're coming up on the moment when Stokes is going to bust himself out of prison and set off to rescue Winters and Riley. I knew I wanted Winters and Riley to have a scene together, and I envisioned it happening in this interrogation room. So Stokes is going to go off and cut the power to the room, and they're going to talk in the meantime. In order to make this happen, I invented a rule about droid poppers, the EMP grenades. The thing is, they're kind of insanely powerful against droids. And as written in Star Wars, there's really no reason why the clones shouldn't just be lobbing droid poppers all over the place. They totally disable the droids, don't provide a risk to the living, you know, people nearby, civilians. It's almost a reverse of the poison from the ashes, if you think about it. They have the answer. It's the droid poppers. So in my movie, the droid popper was a way to get Stokes out of prison, but he needed to be out of them, you know, have none left to save Winters. And that's in the original script. Winters asks, "Do you have any more of those?" And Stokes says, "No, that was my last one." In the age-old rule of show, don't tell, I wanted to scrap those lines. Do you have any more? No, I'm all out. And instead set up a precedent of, well, I only have three. And here's why. And so I invented this little rule that, you know, it works for the movie. It fixes what would otherwise perhaps be a plot hole. But frankly, it kind of could apply to the Star Wars canon also. The rule being that too many EMP grenades nearby might destabilize the batch and pose a danger to those who carry them.
She was a good soldier.
So, in my head canon, you can only carry three.
She will be missed.
This was another scene that began much longer than it ended up, but thankfully I did the trimming before I filmed it this time, so I didn't have to animate anything longer than we see on screen. But Winters' story, his monologue that he's about to deliver, was originally almost 2 pages long in the script. It was a big chunk because, again, I was trying to share information for those who weren't familiar with Star Wars. There was a bit in there about explaining what a holocron is and explaining what the mission was, where they found it. And at this point, I realized that information isn't important. Many, if not most, viewers who are Star Wars fans are going to know what a holocron is. And even for those who don't, the context clues are there. Winters says it's something very important to Dooku. That's all you need to know. You don't need to know what a holocron does. Overall, I'm very happy with how this scene turned out. If I had a do-over, I would actually edit the first interrogation room scene where Winters and Dooku were together. Because to me, Winters seems more upset with Dooku about his betrayal of the Jedi and the Republic and their ideologies. It doesn't actually even mention his wife, Alicia, in the first scene together. He talks about her here, but I would like to have addressed it in the first one because I imagine Winters caring about her. And I think it was an oversight on my part not to have him confront Dooku about that verbally instead of, you know, about the fact that Dooku turned his back on the Jedi and betrayed their ideals. I still like the first scene. I just think it could have been a little bit juicier. It's a bit of a missed opportunity. It's still fine, but I would have done it that way if I had another shot at it.
I've been angry since the beginning of the war.
And now we've come full circle to the initial inciting incident that sparked this whole plot. Right, Riley joining the team was because Dooku killed his sister. Dooku killed his sister because he was angry that Winters escaped after he ambushed him on Coruscant.
Very Jedi-like of me, was it?
It's a bit of a coincidence that Riley and Winters were neighbors, but you know, as far as fantasy stories go, I think there have been bigger stretches to suspend disbelief for. I think it's okay to stomach this one. This little sequence we're going to see here of Dooku watching the hologram broadcast of Winters shooting the holocron, that takes place at the beginning of the movie also, and that was a almost last minute addition. That was in the final few months of production. I decided to put this sequence at the start. Without it, this scene is just exposition. It's fine exposition. It answers the why of Riley's tragedy. Why did it happen? But by putting that little snippet at the beginning without any context, it's like that story from Alfred Hitchcock, right? He said, if you are watching a scene of people talking, sitting at a table for 5 minutes, and then suddenly, boom, an explosion goes off, you as an audience member, you're going to be surprised, sure, but also a little confused, and the scene ahead of it was just ordinary. But if you show the bomb under the table ahead of time, suddenly that 5 minutes is full of building tension. The other good thing about including the sequence at the beginning is that it changes this scene from being new exposition to instead being a callback. You're going to see this scene and go, oh yeah, I remember that. Good chance maybe you've forgotten about it because it was an hour ago, but as soon as you see it again, you're going to go, right, that was right at the beginning. And now everything has come full circle, rather than just introducing new material now for the sake of exposition. It's just a way to wring out just a little extra intrigue from your narrative, you know. Add an element of mystery where maybe there wasn't before. And then it makes getting the answer that much more satisfying.
Indirectly, your sister.
For the sake of Winters' character arc, which extends beyond just this movie, it's an arc, he's completing an arc here that began off-screen. It's important that he comes to this moment of apology, not just necessarily to Riley, but it's full-on accountability. He's been dealing with the grief and guilt over what happened to his wife Alicia because of the act he did in anger, in pettiness. He gave in to that desire to rub it in Dooku's face, and then ultimately it came back to bite him dramatically. So this opportunity to apologize to Riley, it's an externalization of what he has surely been experiencing on the inside all this time. And for Riley, to hear it would give some closure. But I didn't want to go into that element of, how could you, Winters? It's your fault after all. A lot of stories do that with their characters at some point. You know, you have the obligatory rift between comrades before it's eventually mended during the finale of the movie. And there's a time and a place for that, sure. But I never really like it, and I didn't want it in this. So as soon as Riley receives the apology, his reaction is, it's not your fault.
Don't get reckless. Leave Dooku to me. Take care of Jenkins.
And here comes the big fight. It's a little short compared to Star Wars movies because it's animated frame by frame. But there was a lot of intention that went into the choreography. I was trying to make Dooku fight like Dooku. There's a lot of jabs and quick thrusts because he's a fencer, right? Whereas Winters is fighting with that more kind of generic, long slashes, kind of DeGemso Anakin style, right?
You're gonna be okay.
Don't waste your time.
In the original script, Sergeant Stokes came over here with Riley to talk to Lee. There was three of them together. I decided to change that so that this moment was a little more intimate, this little passing of the torch or the radio, I guess. You know, he says, you go off, you live your destiny. This is a private moment between Lee and Riley. And instead, I got to have some fun animating a blaster sequence in the hallway. I'm really happy with how this little shot of shooting the rock wall turned out. It was kind of a spontaneous idea, but I think it paid off. Also, Stokes was carrying this gun around the whole movie, this big gun. He needed to use it at some point. In the original script, Dooku intentionally blasts lightning at the roof to make it fall down on where Lee and Riley in the script, Stokes was as well. But I changed that because it was way too similar to Attack of the Clones. It's the exact same thing he does in Attack of the Clones. So instead, it's a byproduct of the lightning. And this little maneuver that Winters does by pulling Marty's lightsaber to him and injuring Dooku, that wasn't in the script either. It was like an organic idea when I realized, there's another lightsaber on the floor. And that gave me a way to end the fight without killing Dooku, obviously, because Dooku needs to be alive to be in the rest of Star Wars, but also without making Dooku look like a chump, you know? They were relatively evenly matched. Winters was just opportunistic enough to take advantage of what he noticed in the environment around him. And I'm always happy when something can come back around full circle. If something can be a payoff from an earlier sequence, like Marty's lightsaber landing on the floor from his defeat, I think that's a good thing. This sequence of fleeing the mountain was another one of those ones that was in my head from the very beginning. Even when From the Ashes was only just an idea of a 10-minute action sequence, I knew it was going to end by running away from the mountain and then running right back into it.
No, Jax, you can't. We both know that I have to. Let me go. I'll Bruce.
We soon find out that Bruce Stokes has a family, so his offer to go in is one of duty and honor and respect for Winters, but he quickly realizes that Winters is right. It should be Winters that goes.
Captain, give this to Master Kays once you've returned to Coruscant. He'll know what to
this do. Shot right here of Winters leaping over the sandbar. This is another one of those scenes that I had seen in my head over and over again. Seeing it finally come to life was really something special for me. The music that's playing right now is a piece of royalty-free music that came into my possession because one of the tracks on the collection that I bought, many of the tracks in this movie are from a collection of CDs of cinematic royalty-free music, and one of them had a kind of an audio glitch in it, so I had to take it out of the movie, and I originally emailed the company and said, hey, do you have any cleaner files of this? And they were like, sorry, we don't, but how about this one? It's kind of close. Do you like this one? I said, thanks. Yeah. And it ended up being the one while Winters jumps over the sandbar and fights the droids. We are running back through earlier locations in the movie, and every time I finished a scene, there was usually a quick extra shot I had to do of Winters running through it. And I would just tack it on to the end of this scene, and slowly it build towards being complete. A couple of times, I accidentally did it with Winters' helmet still on, and so I had to redo it. I really like this shot of Andy in her phoenix helmet. Of course, From the Ashes being a reference to how a phoenix would burn up and be reborn. It's meant to symbolize, of course, how no matter how bad things get, there is a way forward to the other side of them. And in a meta sense, it also kind of represents how production of this movie stopped at one time and then began again to eventually be finished. And just because I couldn't resist, there is a sound bite of a phoenix or an eagle that screeches as the gunship flies out of the explosion here. So earlier I mentioned there were two deleted scenes. One of them was them in the cafeteria, and the other one used to be right here. One of the first scenes I filmed was what used to be the last scene, because it originally took place back in the apartment Winters was staying in after his own was destroyed. The same one from scene two of the finished movie. And Riley was in that apartment, and the one who came in to speak to him was Maginus, the Jedi from the beginning. And the scene was okay. You know, Mr. Deloey, my high school teacher who voiced Maginus, did a great job. But I realized a few things. I was actually in the shower when this thought hit me, and I went, oh no, I need to redo the last scene. Firstly, I like returning to the bunk room instead of, you know, going all the way back to the apartment. Because the first scene we had here was so light and fun and had all these characters in it bantering. It really helps you feel their absence now. The room is big and empty, and Riley drops his helmet down instead of placing it. And there used to be all these other helmets there, and now they aren't. The environment reminds us of the loss as much as the dialogue does. And it became clear to me that the one to speak to Riley needed to be Stokes. Because he was there. He had a close relationship with everyone on the team, and he experienced that loss with Riley. So there's a level of empathy and understanding there that Maginus, the Jedi, was not going to be able to bring to the conversation. Furthermore, it allowed me to rewrite the scene, because it was fine, but it could be better. It also became really easy for me to write this scene when I was envisioning my dad delivering it, because this is exactly the kind of talk he would have with me if I were going through something like this. I wrote these words, but they're his words.
I have a son about your age.
That line there was not an accident. There are so many changes that I was able to make by sheer luck, you know? Like, I want to be proud of my creation because I created it from scratch, but I feel I was lucky and creative with the opportunities that I kind of gave myself. What I mean by that is, Stokes was meant to be the one here talking to Riley, and by good fortune, I had not written a death scene for him. So I didn't have to change anything about the story in order to allow this scene to happen. He already survived the mission. Just like it was lucky that I hadn't filmed Sev's face yet, and I had time to transform the character of Sev into what she is now.
So will I, Riley. So will I.
I couldn't resist a little line here, nodding to Palpatine, the Supreme Chancellor. I love the dynamic of manipulating both sides of a war and being able to play with the audience and drop a bittersweet line like this.
It's going directly to the Supreme Chancellor as soon as we get home.
So when I was recording lines for Riley in this scene, I was extra sniffly. My partner Carissa moved in with me this year, and she brought with her two lovely kittens. I already had one, Raz, so there are three cats here in the house. And I'm not allergic specifically, but lots of allergens in the air have got me sneezy. And I decided to roll with it. I thought, you know what? Riley's sad. You know, he's been crying. He can be sniffly. Let me just lean into it. So, tons of sniffles. I thought it was authentic. And then I did the first test screening with Carissa, and she said, you're going to want to get rid of those sniffles. There were a lot of sniffles. It was too many.
I told you I'd been a soldier for a long time, but I've been other things too.
Rewriting the characters of Sev and Stokes allowed me to do this little 1-2 punch thing with the theme, setting it up in the first half with Sev and then bringing it home at the end here with Stokes.
The important ones are the ones that hurt the most. I've been where you are. Most people have, in some form or another. I know what real hopelessness feels like.
Not to ruin his moment or anything, but man, filming in those bunk beds was so much harder than I thought it was going to be. I animated him walking all the way over there and sitting down. And then I started trying to fit my fingers in that gap between his arm and the edge of the bed to move his hands. And it was brutal. I should have had him sit on the floor or back in the chair or something.
Keep you down is you.
I'm coming to realize that I will experience a loss of working on this movie. 10 years is a long time for a passion project, and it hasn't sunken in yet that it's finished. I don't know how long it will be before it does. There's still a war to be won. But as much as I'm excited to share it, I will miss it. I will miss working on it. It's just a shame that, and there's some kind of, I don't know, it's fitting, I guess, that the movie itself is a coach for overcoming grief and loss. When it is the movie itself that I will be missing. And in a sense, grieving. Letting go of control. Realizing that I have made the final edit and I can't go back and tweak it anymore. Releasing it out there. It was so exciting, but it was harder than I thought it was going to be. And I'm overwhelmed with joy for how well it's being received. So thank you, everyone, for your kind words so far. One of the questions from the live premiere, this is from user JD Studios, asked, what kept you motivated through such a long project? And chief among those things was the support and encouragement from all you guys. I would post an update every 2 years, and within minutes, some of you had already commented saying how you were still here and still excited, and I couldn't believe it. I was committed to finishing this movie for my own sense of satisfaction and accomplishment. And I'd like to think that I would have been able to do it no matter what. But truly, the support from you guys on YouTube and from my friends and my family, that's what kept me going. That's what made it worth the 8-hour photo shoots and the achy muscles and the overnight editing sessions, was knowing I was going to get to share it. So thank you. Finishing this project has been the joy of my life so far. So I, excuse me, I have a few more questions from the premiere I want to get through and not forget. User CBL Animation asks, what was my favorite minifigure in the movie? I am personally partial to Lee and Marty's designs with the kind of devil tail and little horn going up their helmets. To combo that with another question from user Jonathan Miller, where did I get the minifigures from? Most of the pieces I already owned. Between me and my brother, we had a sizable Lego collection, and then the sets and figures were all just from stuff we had. The only things I had to order online were 8 of the Commander Fox torsos, which were used for the team's uniform. I needed to order a bunch of Battle Droid legs, because I cut them with an X-Acto knife so that I could swivel them, and I just needed a bunch of extra because I knew I was going to mess some of them up. And I ordered blank clone trooper helmets that I could paint. The first iteration, the old, the 2005 helmets were done with like a red marker, and then the newer ones from the second half of the movie were done with like miniature paint and brushes. I'd like to toss in a fun fact of my own here. The final photo count for the entire production of the movie was 66,140 photographs. And that just delights me. Because, you know, the execute order. Some of the questions that I have here were already answered at earlier parts in the commentary. But the last one that came up a couple of times was, what's coming next? What will I do now? The movie is over. What are my next plans? And the answer is, I don't know. I don't know. But I am excited to find out. I have had this on my to-do list for so long. I don't quite know what it feels like yet not to have a project on the go. So I'm gonna see what that feels like for a little bit. But I love filmmaking. I love storytelling. I specifically love Lego stop motion. And I just loved working on this project. I think it is very unlikely that I'm done forever. Especially since I kind of already have a sequel idea. No promises. I'd like to take one final opportunity to thank each and every one of you for watching. It just fills me with so much joy to finally share this movie with all of you. I want to thank the cast, and specifically, I'd like to leave an extra special thank you to Jeff Haskins, Hunter Freeman, and Boyd Little, three of my bandmates from way back in the day, who provided some lines of dialogue that didn't make it into the final movie. Especially Boyd, who was the voice of Sev before the change. Thank you guys, and I hope you're doing well. I went back and forth about whether or not to include this little post-credits scene. Ultimately, I decided to do it because I was afraid I would regret not doing it once I had the idea, you know? But also because the payoff, the finale of the movie, was celebrating that Riley was going to be a Jedi. And as the Star Wars fans know, it's kind of a bad time to be a Jedi. So this sequence showing Order 66, it at least addresses the possibility that Riley might have just been killed immediately in Order 66, and it shows that that is not what happened. Riley and Stokes have a fighting chance that maybe we'll explore in a sequel. No promises, but maybe. My name is Brendan from Make Noise Man Studios. Thank you so much for watching, and may the Force be with you. Problem.